Today on Soul Work for Moms. Today's episode is about surrender. It's about trusting the process, but really it's about postpartum depression. Today, Olivia Jeanette is sharing her story of postpartum depression and how she decided to embrace it. She's now on the other side of her depression and says it was truly a gift. You'll hear that Olivia chose to not treat her postpartum depression with drugs, so it's important for me to remind you that I'm not a doctor or counselor, and if you think that you may be suffering from postpartum depression, please consult with your healthcare provider for individual advice regarding your own situation. Today's show format is a little different. The first 10 minutes or so, you'll be hearing clips from Olivia as she reads an email that she sent to me describing her postpartum depression and her unique perspective on it. Afterwards, you'll hear the conversation that I had with Olivia about her experience and how she came to see her postpartum depression as a gift. Olivia is a married mother of two, homemaker, traditional Usui Tibetan Reiki master of 16 years, an intuitive, a lover of nature and our oneness with all, and a former naturalist with a mission of peace through presence. She's an only child herself, whose mother passed away in 2002, and she starts her email off describing a time when she felt nothing short of blessed.
Being an only child, I thought, well, my son needs a sib. I always wanted one myself, so I felt it was time. I had the good fortune of getting pregnant with a little girl. I was very excited to do this pregnancy different by attending doula-taught classes and having a birth doula, changing doctors, and most importantly, having a natural VBAC. I was not as educated the first time and learned a lot from what had happened. Well, I got my doula, took my classes, did calming birth meditations at night, did yoga. It was awesome. Even the day my daughter was born was pretty awesome because I had just had lunch with my son, husband, and in-laws, middle of the work week, which is so random. And I went into labor at the restaurant. Everyone was there. I was fully supported. It was a dream. Labor was very quick. Okay, I was pushing in the car, so that was a little scary. And I had my unmedicated VBAC with a terrific doctor, doula, and hospital team. I was elated. I did it. I had a VBAC. This was huge. My baby girl breastfed immediately. What a pro. Geez, my two birth stories were night and day. Life is good. A week later, I am home alone with both kids. I can do this. Okay, it's true, my son is extremely touchy and impulsive, although he radiates love at all times, but he doesn't totally get the fragility of this new child. This is tough. Oh man, I literally have to be right next to her 24/7. This is hard. Ooh, I'm tired. I'm having to scold my son a lot. I am trying to be a really good mommy. Well, I am a stay-at-home mom, so I better keep the house totally spotless and have dinner maybe made too. Oh, Sprout Channel, thank you for existing. You are my village right now. Oh, but I hate to put my son in front of this cartoon. Oh, well, did I mention I'm tired? I love you, coffee.
Things stayed this way for Olivia for several months.
Wow, my son is really trying me. I have been really yelling super loud at him a lot. I feel terrible and I need to cry. I love this little guy. His impulses are really hard to handle. He is only two, but I need him to be like five now. Come on, little two-year-old. You have this wisdom in your eyes. Grow up. Be five already. I need help. Crap, you have two-year-old needs. He's a challenging little fellow. I love him so much.
Olivia finds herself completely laid out on the ground, crying and totally begging in prayer to be kinder to her son.
God, help me, please. Please help me. Mother Mary, please help me. Please help me to be the best mom I can be.
And Olivia hasn't even gotten to her newborn daughter yet. And now, although she's gotten everything she's wanted, it's feeling really hard.
This girl, with all knowing eyes, she fascinates me. She keeps me on the couch, the chair, or the bed all the time during cluster feeds, and I can't get a boob break. This is really hard. Oh, but it's everything I always wanted because I couldn't breastfeed my son. I am missing this whole experience through stress, major sleep deprivation, and lack of tribe. OMG, I have to potty train my son ASAP and get him in preschool the second he turns 3. I'm going crazy. He needs something more. I can't be everything for both of them. My daughter really wants to be close to me all the time, and I want to be close to her. I can't co-sleep with her because our bedroom is too cold. No, I can't turn on the space heater because she is waking and sleeping with the pattern of it turning off and on. She has to go in her bedroom. I stay with her. I never leave her. She cries and cries so hard. I feel terrible for her, but I never leave her. I have to sleep train her. My room is just too cold to co-sleep.
The sleep deprivation went on for 6 months, and Olivia had very little help.
I am so tired. Am I doing everything right? Of course I am. I'm more than a super mom, but I never feel like it. Nobody knows. My husband doesn't even get it. How could he? It's his first rodeo with 2 kids, too. I don't reach out. I have no siblings. I have no mother. Am I doing this right? My aunt came once. That was nice. My mother-in-law helped a lot at the beginning, but it stopped after a while. It's funny, though. I don't even know how to calm down and relax and let them help because I feel like I need to entertain a guest. I didn't have that comfort level with anybody.
Her son starts school, but it provides little relief as his teachers have some observations for Olivia.
It is rough for him on the first day, only 2 hours. I feel terrible that he has these strange behaviors in a group setting, and I am getting a call about a 3-year-old by the second day. Can I drop an F-bomb, then cry my heart out? They basically tell me that I might want to have my son evaluated and hint at the fact that I have postpartum depression. Oh yeah, there it was. 7 months after my daughter's birth, someone finally said it. I knew it was true and wondered how many others saw it too. Wanted to help, but didn't know how because I put on my brave face all the time. So I am hearing my son might have some problems and that I might have postpartum depression all at the same time. Alarms ringing in my ears, heart pounding, tears streaming. Feeling totally helpless and alone. Yeah, what a complete mind trip.
Olivia said her hormone levels continued to fluctuate as she breastfed for about 20 months, but things changed for her soon after that trip at 9.5 months when her monthly cycle resumed. That was Olivia in 2011 and 12. Here's what she says now, looking back on that time.
Wow. That time was so tough. Much of it is seriously a blur. And postpartum can last much longer than one thinks. There are phases, in my opinion, of postpartum depression. I have read up to 4 years. What I know now and what kept me strong is this. To my core, I knew with all of my heart who I was. I was strong, intuitive, and close with God.
And Olivia describes how she decided that medication was not how she ultimately chose to get through her postpartum depression.
To my core, I knew medication was not for me. Maybe for some, but not me. When people wanted to help, offering ideas of medication, it took me to a place deep within, knowing who I am. And trusting what I knew to be right for me. That is very hard when everyone is looking at you funny when you are in the midst of postpartum depression and not acting yourself.
Olivia says in the midst of her depression, she had a perspective shift that completely changed how she looked at her depression. And that perspective shift allowed her to embrace it.
Yes, I was acting myself. I have postpartum depression. This is happening. I am embracing it. I love myself. Depression is not bad. It's just a thing. I am aware this is happening to me, and I am fully experiencing it. This is okay. Damn, am I getting some serious inner work done? Holy shit, my depression is a gift. Don't let anyone take that away from you. So yes, through stay-at-home mom mothering, which was my choice, and postpartum depression, which both are extremely isolating in our American culture, I got an opportunity to pour myself into my inner work. No, I am not melancholy. Bug off. I'm doing my inner work, people. I had to dig deep. Yes, there are some regrettable moments, but I have to forgive myself. And I talked with my kids, acknowledging how I was feeling at that time, how I yelled a lot, and I felt really bad about that, how I wasn't quite myself, and how I wasn't really being the mom that I really wanted to be. It really was freeing to acknowledge that with them in a kid-friendly way, and now to be showing them who I am and can be for them.
This is how Olivia describes what postpartum depression did for her life.
Postpartum depression helped me to work through a lot of suppressed emotion and find that inner peace, that inner strength, inner love that we all possess. In the very end, it actually helped my marriage.
And finally, Olivia wants to share these words to any woman who can relate with the things that she's just described.
Stay strong in yourself and stay vulnerable all at the same time. We are always supported on a spiritual level. We just need to ask for it. And we must reach out for the physical support through friends, families, postpartum doula work, counseling, you name it. Never feel less than when you are in the midst of postpartum depression. Embrace it. Embrace those who accept you right where you are. Do not fear it. Try and bring yourself to understand that if we weren't meant to experience depression, then God wouldn't give it to us. I know, that's a lot to wrap your head around. But would you ever question joy? Isn't that something we can also feel and was given to us as a gift to experience? Make sure to love yourself, and you really are okay.
And now my conversation with Olivia Jeanette. You talked about some of the pressures that you were experiencing, and I wonder, where do you think that those pressures were coming from? Like having a spotless house and dinner on the table? And I think you're definitely not alone. We all feel that in some way. So where do you think that those pressures come from?
Well, you know, I think I have a lot to say on this because I've had the time to think about it for a while now, at least 2 years since I did have postpartum depression. But overall, I truly believe this is totally cultural. You know, in the American culture, it can be completely different than the way childbirth and mothering is experienced somewhere else around the world. And we are, I think many mothers here are just not privy to that information, how different things can be. We only know one way. I definitely did. And this is really funny, but it's so, so true. I always go back, and this is amazing. This is how much media can influence positively or negatively. I go back to the episodes of Leave It to Beaver, and I play that over in my head. I do not know how old I was when I was watching that, but I remember Barbara Billingsley, the lead role mom actress, perfectly neat, tidy house. Dinner was always made. Her hair looked awesome. You know, she just, hello, children, how was your day? She had it all together. And I remember that, and that played through my head a lot. I even brought that up in conversation to my husband. And luckily, you know, he's a little more progressive, but he's like, oh, it doesn't have to be like that. And I'm like, yeah, right. We're the same age, buddy. You know, I think we both hold a little bit of maybe, I'm assuming that was 1950s mentality. And I went to an all-girls high school. Mm-hmm. And I grew up not learning in any of those classes how to mother. I didn't learn about sisterhood in the way that I wished that I would have. I learned to get out in the workforce, get my diploma or two first, and then get a plaque on the wall and get my awards.
Absolutely.
That was my driving force.
Yeah.
And it took me a long time to realize that you're not going to get that. I had to wrap my head around that. You know, I was never taught how to do this. And the worth that I have in doing this and the great importance for myself and my children. So that was a really big aha moment, honestly.
What did your mother look like? Like, what did you see at home?
I was in a single parent home. My parents were divorced early, and my mom worked her butt off. And this is how, you know, you really can't compare one person's story to another. You can take what you need and leave the rest, because we're all so individual. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I had to start taking care of myself early because she, you know, mm-hmm. you know, wasn't home, you know, or I was in a latchkey program. And,
so it's not like you had a leave it to Beaver mom that you were feeling like you needed to live up to that also.
No, isn't that funny? I didn't. But I feel like I started momming myself pretty early. I think it's a role that you can kind of fall into when that happens. So yeah, that is really interesting. I didn't see that, but that's what I was trying to live up to.
And it sounds like through your story that you have a really close connection to faith. Is that true?
You know, luckily it really, really is. All I can truly say about that, and this is such a blessing for me, and it's always a journey, but I've always felt connected, even as a little girl, and I can't put that into words. And it didn't always come in a traditional religious sense, although, you know, I was offered a religious path growing up. But there was just always this connection that I always felt that I never could put into words. And as I've gotten older, it's so fun for me. Spirituality is very fun for me. And so luckily it just kind of comes natural, although it's been tested, you know, in times like that and even to now. But yeah, I've just always had this, I know that God is with me. I know that God is in me.
And what did that look like for you during that time when you say it did test you?
It was all I had. Excuse me. It was all I had. I don't think I questioned it at that time, but I mean, I was just like I said, I was laid out on the floor, like praying, like just so helpless. I knew I had that. You always have that. It never goes away. So, you know, I did feel like I had divine help at all times, but let's be honest. I mean, whether you have postpartum depression or not, sometimes you're in survival mode when you're that sleep deprived, you know? And so everything's kind of a blur, but I knew I had that.
Did you have any girlfriends, or, you know, you said that you were missing a tribe. So what kind of tribe were you longing for, or what kind of tribe do you think that you needed that you didn't have during that time?
Well, I know what I needed, and this is just kind of part of the individual journey for me, but I just really needed someone that knew me through and through, like a mother or like a sister, a sister that you grew up with that you can just be completely comfortable with if you want to just lay around in your bra and underwear. I mean, just someone that you can let go with and be like, you know what? I know you've got this. I got to go lay down. I didn't have that comfort level mm-hmm. with others.
Did you wish that you had that at the time, but just hadn't yet had anyone that you had built those relationships with yet? Or were you just not able to reach out to those people?
Well, I think it's a little bit of both. I do have very solid relationships with my girlfriends. But yes, I wished so deeply at that time that I had, you know, there's just a feeling, a bond that you have with family, you know, that that's known you since you were a little girl, that just it's energetic. And I needed that. My girlfriends, God love them, you know, they were raising babies too, and they could only give so much of themselves. And even my mother-in-law, amazing, amazing woman, you know, an angel in my life. She did what she could, but I'm sure it was more difficult for me to open up fully to her. And that put her in a difficult position. I know she would have done it for me, but, you know, sometimes you do. You just kind of feel like, you just can't let go. But for some people they can, and that is a blessing if you can.
What would have helped you that without having to ask for it?
There's two things here, a little bit of a tangent, but making those meals and dropping them off when you are first having a child or even later down the road, that meant everything to me. I never even knew about like the food train or anything like that till I had my first and I came home from the hospital and there was a meal at my front porch and I was crying my eyes out. Like, this is the best meal I've ever had. I can just taste the love in this. And it meant the world to me. It was from someone I worked with, you know, not even a family member. And I, ever since that moment, the way it touched me, I have done that for as many mamas as I have been able to. I will make that meal and I will hook you up, you know, because it was everything. And as far as what I needed that I couldn't ask for, this goes back to we as women and men, we need to be educated on this. And you're right. If it's not going to start somewhere in a classroom, it's these kind of movements. What Soul Work for Moms is, it's a Facebook page. It's a support group. It's a meetup group. It is something. We have got to do this. I mean, this will create a shift for, you know, all of us and just... And for the children to be better nurtured and supported if mommy and daddy are too. We all want this.
Yeah.
We all want this for families, but we don't know how. And it is so hard for so many women like myself to ask for help. You know, it's embarrassing almost. It can be.
Did you mean educated on postpartum depression or educated about everything that goes into raising a family and the needs that a child has from his or her parents?
I would start with, it takes a village, being there for the family and the needs of the family. And starting there to hopefully curb postpartum depression for some. Like, I know that can still happen. It's so physical, mm-hmm. but that could potentially make or break a situation for some people, you know? So yeah, we need to be educated.
I like how you phrase that because I don't think that, we're definitely in this conversation, not trying to say that if you just have support, you won't have postpartum depression. There are for sure significant hormonal things that can be triggered through this. But I love that you point out that maybe we can curb some of that. Maybe we can help someone not go down that path of feeling like you're so alone and that there's too much to do, because maybe we can just make it so that there's not as much to do, right? And that we can make it so that women aren't, we just aren't feeling so alone. Is that right?
Yes. And, you know, if it's not family, there's postpartum doula work. There's several ways to do it. And something that we have to enforce for ourselves, and this goes across any, you know, episode, but we've all heard about self-care. It's so important. It is so important. And something I realized about myself, I hope this isn't too much of a digression, but because of the way I was raised and I got the 9-to-5 job and you clock in and you clock out, well, I chose to be a stay-at-home mother and I took my job seriously. This was my job, but nobody told me to clock out. You have to tell, you're your own boss. You have to tell yourself to clock out. And I would not do it. And it was like this aha moment that took me, what, 5 years, 7 years? I have a 7-year-old.
Right.
I mean, I realized you are not clocking out.
Yeah.
You got to do that, girlfriend.
And so I know I'm hearing all kinds of moms right now thinking, I can't clock out. There is no clock out. At 5 o'clock, the kid, you know, we just can't do that. And so what would you say to them? When do you clock out? When is it little times through the day? Is it, you know, it'll be different for everyone, but what does that look like for you?
Yeah, now, well, right. That's like, if I could have gone back and realized that, you're going to have to manage your day, you know, the best that you can. But nap time, if you've got nappers, you know, clock out. Even if you can say, I'm doing this for 15 minutes. When, if you are in a marriage and you're not single parenting, don't assume all of the duties. Like when you, if you do work, or even if outside of the home, or you work as a homemaker, when somebody needs to fold the laundry, have your partner do it and go soak your feet in the tub.
Yeah. And I want to transition now to the time when your son started school.
So you pick up your son and the teachers are hinting that you have postpartum depression, and you said you knew it was true. Had you had these thoughts in your head prior to the teachers voicing that to you?
Well, I you know, when they said it, I remember being like, oh yeah, you know you're right. And I did, that must have been when I started taking steps online and seeing where I was, you know, there's different severities of it. And starting to hone in on, yep, this is me, this is me, speaking about it with my husband.
So was it open then? Did you reach a point in the midst of it when you and your husband were talking about it? Like, man, I think I'm going through postpartum depression right now.
We didn't talk about me as much because I was freaking out, which is probably part of it. That they're telling me that my son might need an evaluation. And so I was taking steps forward with that than with me. So, yeah.
Yeah, like talk about adding fuel to the fire. You're already overwhelmed. And then a teacher saying like, hey, we might need to have your son evaluated. I mean, that is just, I can only imagine how much that would only make things seem even worse, right?
I mean, it was just totally a mind trip. It really was at that point. And I'm not of sound mind at that point, and we know it. And, you know, that's just a whole nother thing to be dealing with that and trying to bring it up to your partner and what their thoughts might be and, you know, what family might think and things that I already thought might be true even with him. And it, oh my goodness. Yeah, it was a lot.
And how did you know that medication was not for you?
Well, it is, and everybody is different. It really just comes down to who I am as an individual. I am, I would have done anything with herbs or homeopathics or energy work. And I did. I would do anything like that. But I just am not a person that often ever wanted to take synthetic drugs. And that really was just a personal choice. I didn't want to, I didn't feel that that was going to take care of things. I thought that it would only mask what needed to be seen. And I was concerned if I did do that, would it come right back when I was finished? Because I wanted to be finished if I ever did try it. And it just totally, totally individual.
Okay, so then we come to what you call perspective shift. You said you had a ton of inner work that you got to do and that you feel like it was a gift. What was the inner work?
Yes, this, I'm like smiling. Yes, you know, I can see this. That perspective shift was huge. It was retrospect.
Okay.
This didn't happen fully until after I was finished with postpartum depression. But, you know, some did happen within. Because if I realized I was doing inner work while I was having postpartum depression, there was some perspective shift there. Mm-hmm. I just gained a lot more after. Mm-hmm. You know, when I talk about inner work, inner work is yucky and awesome. I mean, that for me, when I say suppressed emotion, I generalized because it's something we all have, and there's different ways of suppressing it, and those wanted to come up and out. And I felt like being a stay-at-home mother, it gave me time to do that. During nap, actually, that's what I would do with nap time. I started meditating and much more frequently, and I just would sit with myself and I would sit with these feelings and just be like, ooh, yuck, aha, these are coming up for me to deal with. And you know, it was a process, you know, it was not just like a week, it was a year. And, you know, I'm not going to go into specifics of suppressed emotion because we all have different ones. I can fast forward a bit, But at that time, in that moment, you know, I looked really sad and I was okay with it because I knew that inner work brings that up, and that I felt so grateful to have that blessing, to have that time to do that. Because really, I mean, yeah, you're busy at home, but when you're at work, there's a lot of people around you, a lot of chatty, a lot of whatever. You're in their energy, you know, all the time and working together as a team, which is awesome, but not having a moment by yourself unless you go to the bathroom.
So would you say that your postpartum depression was a gift?
Yes, 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 I would. I really felt like that was a way that I could get in touch with those feelings that needed to come up and out and be loved and seen as a part of me and not be scared of them. When we are in this hustle bustle world, and for some of us, you just don't have time to get in touch, you know, or maybe that's really how I am, but I was given that time. And so that was a gift to me. Yeah. Yeah. And get low down, sad, you know, with the postpartum, and it just all happened naturally.
Olivia, if you could go back and do anything differently, would you?
I definitely would. You know, towards the end of this interview and re-listening to my own email and the struggles I was having, I wish so deeply that I would have gone to counseling really on the early end. That would have just been such a great start. And, you know, postpartum depression creeps up on you. You don't even realize it's happening. So, you know, just having someone in my corner, even, you know, being aware of it and speaking up about it, nudging me like, hey, you know, I wish I would have known about that early. Like, yeah. Hey, if I'm falling apart here, let me know. And also in listening to my email again, you know, this was all true. When I wrote that, I was just re-feeling everything. So it really was from the heart. But I am like, hey, wait a second. I didn't yell that much. You know, I forgot to talk about the millions of times that I wasn't yelling and we were having a blast and just constantly playing. So there was so much of that too. And, you know, even though I did struggle a little extra with some impulsivity from my son, I don't want to harp on that because he is just such a light in this world that, you know, supersedes anything I was, you know, dealing with. But at that moment, in that time, that was the realness of it. And I had to say that because it was true. But, you know, I'm looking back now and rehearing my email. So I just wanted to put that out to all your listeners too.
Yeah, well, and absolutely. And I think that that even speaks to postpartum depression, that when we're in those moments, that that is our reality, like you said, and that it's hard to see anything else sometimes. It's hard to see all of the light and the bright, even though it's there. And so I think that also speaks to you being out of it now, you know, that you can look back and you can see like, oh, actually my boy was all of the beauty that he is that whole time. I was just maybe being triggered by the depression. Is that right?
You know it. Absolutely. Yeah. That is, you put that together really, really well, but I'm glad I got a chance to say that. And yes, to all the mamas and everyone else listening for mamas, you know, be aware and just reach out. That is so important in this whole message today. Reach out and get your help.
Yeah. And would you say that you just woke up one day and realized, oh, I think I'm through this? Or was it a gradual process? How did you know? Because you speak of your postpartum depression in the past tense now.
I do. It happened in phases. You know, there was a point at about 9 months where my cycle came back. And I guess physically that must have been hormones because I did have a big breakaway at that point. I mean, it was like, oh, this is amazing. I feel so much different. But it wasn't entirely gone. I think some of this, and this is choice, this is individual, some of my phases are the fact that I have been a stay-at-home mother by choice, and it is slightly isolating. I truly think that plays into it a little bit. You know, your own chemical makeup plays into it, but just the more and more you see the light and you can see things for what they are, and you can change your perspective, then you see your way out of it. And, you know, I visited a counselor, you know, 3 years into this when I thought I was fully out. And I visited her because I wanted to best learn how to love myself. And in doing that, it was awesome. But, it, you know, it brought a little bit back because I had to do some more inner work. And maybe that wasn't postpartum, but it was a little depressive. But, you know, it was just a continuing part of the journey. And now I get to share this story with a smile on my face at the end, knowing I'm not perfect, but really hoping that I can help somebody else.
It's so beautiful. Olivia, thank you for sharing your story. It's a beautiful story. You speak about it so eloquently, so beautifully. And I really connect with you and especially your email. When I hear it, I just feel like I'm right there with you and I could relate to so much of what you said. And I think so many mothers listening will as well. So I want to ask you, what is one thing that you want all mothers to know?
Okay, well, there's one and then a bonus one. I have two.
All right.
So my first one really is, say this over and over to yourself. When you are at your lowest, trust the process. Trust the process, because it really just makes you surrender. I mean, what else is there to do than trust that process and surrender into it? I really feel like that is so helpful when you're just in that space. And the other one is, don't ever feel or let anyone else make you feel like you are broken. Because at your soul essence, who you are, that piece of God inside you, that is perfect divine wholeness at all times. You are never, ever truly broken. So just remember that.
And you have not only one soul work action step, but several soul work action steps for us to do. Could you share those with us?
Okay, I have three soul work action steps. And my first one is, turn on your jams. Get on Pandora or Spotify or something and pick a song that is going to evoke the emotion you want to have or that you need to release. And that'll help you wiggle it out. You might cry, you might laugh. Turn on those jams, move that body. My second action step, and I said this in the interview, is hug yourself. Literally cross your hands over your heart and rub your arms and hug yourself. And when you get through that hug and you start feeling a little more warm and fuzzy, just name one thing that you're grateful for. It can be, I am grateful for breathing, you know, and just see what that feels like for you. And thirdly, I do have a third action step. I like to write lists down and I like to knock them out. Like, you know, I got this done, I got this done, I got this done. But what I ask you to do is not write down what you think you need to accomplish, but write down what you did accomplish. This seemingly insignificant tasks like, I brushed my teeth, I fluffed my pillows, I made my kids breakfast. I mean, those are the things you don't think you need to check off, but you do. And that list is long and it feels good. So that's my third.
So many thanks to Olivia Jeanette for being incredibly open and vulnerable in sharing her story with us today. As I mentioned earlier, Olivia is a traditional Usui Tibetan Reiki master. She provides gentle, natural energy balancing in a peaceful environment for women and children alike through Reiki, chakra alignment, color vibrational balancing, energy clearing, and angel therapy. If you'd like to connect with Olivia about her services, you can find her contact information in the show notes at soulworkformoms.com. You'll also find links to some other people that Olivia recommends, as well as links to some organizations providing postpartum depression support. If you feel like you are suffering from postpartum depression, please reach out to someone to talk. You do not have to suffer alone. There is a whole community of women and mothers who are here for you. And speaking of community, are you in our new Facebook group? If not, that's where you'll find me in between shows, as well as many of the guests that you've heard from here. And as a member of the group, you're automatically entered into our contests and giveaways. And there are a couple going on right now, such as downloadable keynote presentations from our guest from last week, Beth Nowak. And I'm giving away 2 diaper genies on November 30th. So if you've got some moms to be that you know who could use a diaper genie, tell them to join the Soul Work for Moms Facebook group and they might win one. Just search for the group on Facebook or go to soulworkformoms.com/community and you'll be sent straight there. As always, thank you for listening to the show, but more importantly, Thank you for being willing to show up each and every day and listen to your soul calling you to heal. When you heal your wounds through soul work, you truly heal the world, and that is evolution through mothering. Thanks for listening. I'll talk to you next time.